Welcome back to Who's Your One. Jesus left the 99 and went after just one. You know, our vision statement that we have for our church, you hear it in UIO. We probably don't display it enough. We demonstrate it by our priorities and our practices. And every time we ring the bell, we're putting an exclamation point on our vision statement. But it's partnering. This is our church's mandate. We're going to partner with God to transform our community, Cape Coral, Lee County, and our world, one life at a time, for God's glory. Now, that should be every church's motto, but it's certainly ours. And don't miss the beginning of it. And each word we've labored over and you know, just like getting community and our world, that we added those words, and our world, when we became missional beyond local. And it cost us as a church. People, why would we care for other? We got plenty of needs right at home. And, you know, and that sounds so spiritual, but there's a Judas heart. Why wasn't this money used, sold, and used to, you know, to this waste of the woman that worship Jesus with her alabaster box? It sounded like he cared about the money, but it was control and greed. And so anyway, partnering with God, that concept is what this series is all about. It's not trying to get God to do something. It's us joining God in what he's already doing. He's already in pursuit of your one that he puts in front of you, that bundle that he entrusts you with, that open door that he gives you, that opportunity, that burden that he puts on your heart, that calling as an ambassador to represent him. Who's your one is God inviting you to partner with him. Because to do it without him, it's impossible. And we become so many bad types of a witness when we're doing it in our own strength, and our own energy, and our own persuasion. We want God to work in us and God to work through us so that we can be witnesses for him. Who's your one? Partnering with God. Now I want you to look with me in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Paul is kind of trying to address an issue of jealousy and competition and rivalry about who's the best leader in the church, and, well, I'm following this one and I'm following that one, and he wants to just tear down the personality cults of that day, which we certainly have plenty of today in our world. And he does it by describing what it means to be a spiritual gardener. So I want you to learn about God's gardening in this message. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 5. What, after all, or who, what, in other words, who's Apollos? And that's somebody that was a famous teacher then, or well-known and popular, and people were polarizing around Apollos. And he said, and who's Paul who's writing this? I'm nothing. What are we? He says, only your servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord has assigned to each his task. So there are people in our church that have come to Christ through myself, through Pastor Kim, Pastor Jace, Pastor Charles. There are people that have come to Christ through you reaching out to them and investing and inviting in them and bringing them to church. But we're instruments, we're tools, we're ambassadors, but we're nothing. We're a tool that the gardener, our God, uses to work in his garden. We're only tools. We're just instruments. Now, it's an honor to be an instrument, but you don't bow down and say, man, this hammer is so amazing that just built this piece of furniture, or this paintbrush. Oh my gosh, this is such a powerful, beautiful, I'm gonna worship this paintbrush instead of the person that used the brush to paint the amazing painting. Paul's saying, get your eyes off the tools. And then he says this, he's using this gardening analogy. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God made it grow. So it's not him that plants or him that waters as anything. Only God makes things grow. And then he says, the man who plants and the man who waters have one purpose. Each will be rewarded according to their labor, for we're God's fellow workers. The only place in the Bible this term is used. We're partners. We're God's fellow workers, and you're God's field or garden, and you're God's building. These are such powerful, when you think about being an ambassador or being a shepherd that's seeking the lost or being a good neighbor that's caring for people and taking that bundle or being an intercessor and praying for people. God says that there's a process to people coming to faith. Now, there's the human side and there's the divine side. And in this, you see the human side as Paul talks about watering and planting in verse 6. He uses this analogy that God uses different tools, instruments, some to help get the seed in, some to help put water on the seed, you know, some to cultivate and weed the garden. And it's none of that makes the seed come alive. That's only what God can do. But God has chosen, and that's the amazing thing about him. He invites us to include us in the process of one lost sheep coming back to Jesus. Who's your one? I hope you're praying for those people that God has targeted you, those ones that he's put on your heart. And I hope you're willing to plant the seed in them. Hope you're, whether it's through inviting them to church or sharing scripture, sharing your story, because we all have a story to tell. About, and if you don't have a story to tell, if you can't, as Paul said, say, I'm a new creation in Christ, if there's not a Jamie before Jesus and a Jamie that's totally different after Jesus or becoming different, not perfect, then there's something missing. The transformation comes from being reconciled to God. We become his friends and lovers of God and worshipers of God. But we have this calling to be gardeners, to plant seeds. Not every seed that you plant, you're going to see immediately grow. My wife and I have had the joy of planting seeds around the world as we go. A touch here, a prayer there, a witness here, an act of buying somebody. One of the favorite things we love to do to help plant seeds, because it's a process. It's not always just engage them with the gospel and call them to repentance. Sometimes our job is just to water the seed, not as a cop-out to say we'll never share, but we love to pay for people's meals, especially when we don't let the people know it was us. And we include others, usually a waitress, in the process of telling the person that their meal was paid for to remind them that Jesus loves them. We've seen waitresses break down crying when we've given them the assignment. And which, by the way, when we do that, we give a great tip to the waitress. And one of the worst things I think in the world that was invented, potentially one of the worst, is that there's lots worse, but it's this Bible tract which has verses on it, and it's made in the form of a $100 bill. And people would put it under their placemat or under their bill at a restaurant, and you open it and it says, here's a tip for you. Now think of a single mom, got a baby, two babies at home, can't afford diapers, can't afford milk. She sees this couple, bow their heads, pray a prayer. They're obviously believers. They order lobster and steak and filet mignon and have a massive bill. And they give some cheap tip, like barely 10%. And then they add a Bible tract that says, here's a tip for you. That's a horrible ambassador. Now, here's the way you could have done it. be kind to the waitress before you say your blessing. Say, hey, real quick, we're going to say the blessing for this food. Is there something we could pray for you about? Now, if they're too busy, you let them go. But if they say, yeah, my child at home's got a fever. What's the child's name? Oh, little Mikey. Okay, we're going to pray for Mikey. And so we let her go, and we pray for Mikey at the table. Or we pray a blessing on the waitress and just in general, or waiter. Then leave a big, generous tip. Now, if you want to add a Bible tract, if you put a real $100 bill, now they may pay attention to whatever it is that you give to them. See, we believe that coming to Christ, reaching the lost, it's a process. It's not just a one and done. People need many, 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 many touches, reminders, touches, prayers, witnesses, invited to church, somebody do kind deeds for them. We try to take this approach at our church here, that not just that we see the process, but that we want to be waterers of the seeds that have been sown in the people's lives. And how do we do that? Well, we do it through free food. We do it through hot dogs on Halloween. We do it through hot dogs on bike night. You say, how does that help any? It's a simple little touch. People demean it because of its simpleness. But we've seen more cool things happen by people that are like, well, why is it free? We just wanted to remind you that Jesus loves you, no strings attached. We call it servant evangelism. It's being representatives of Christ with generosity, which we're going to do in our groups. Hopefully, you'll take the pizza challenge, and you're going to order a pizza, and we're going to put together the largest tip that delivery person has ever had in their life. You get good pizza because God bless, and you're going to be generous, not just because you're a nice person. We don't just do generous things. There's lots of philanthropists that give millions. Bill Gates, millions of dollars for good causes. Doesn't make him a Christian. He's doing it in the name of the Gates Foundation. It's not in the name of Jesus. I don't know where he stands with God. Maybe he's a Christ follower. I don't know. But just being nice and generous doesn't make you an ambassador. It doesn't make you a witness. It doesn't make you a Christ follower, but when you do it in his name. We'll never be persecuted for doing food ministry in the name of humanity, in the name of just being kind people. But when you do things in the name of Jesus, not to be preachy or condescending, but to say, here's why. We're here to represent God. It's not bait and switch. Hey, we'll feed you and whoop, we're going to, like one church locally did, invited police officers back when my wife and I were chaplains. They shared with us how offended and upset they were, though they never let on. But a church had a steak breakfast for the police, and a whole shift of them came. And then the preacher got up while they were eating the steak, and he just preached a condescending, you need Jesus or you're going to hell message. The police were entirely put off. And it was a bait and switch. It was like, we didn't really want to feed you a breakfast. We didn't really want to honor you. We didn't really want to just bless you. We wanted to just use this to shove down your throat the Bible. That's ineffective at best, offensive at worst. None of those cops would have felt drawn to go to that church. But when you do stuff to just say, we want to bless you, that doesn't mean it's wrong. Like when we do dinner church and we're not saying you can't eat if you don't hear the message. It's just we want to feed you spiritually and physically. We care about both. And if people only want the physical meal, they can get up and walk out. There's nobody got them trapped. It's not like rescue missions I used to preach at, which hardcore people off the street. They made them hear the gospel sermon, and then they gave them the meal. And that's bait and switch. Actually, that's forced, not baiting, it's forced. And then you get, you know, and it was just never, it's just not effective. But sowing and reaping, sowing and watering, it's a process. And I love how he says, he compares himself, that he's planted, Apollos watered, God made it increase. So he says in verse 7, it doesn't matter who does what job. God's the miracle worker. God's the one that brings new life. And then to be able to say in verse 9 that we are God's fellow workers. It's not just that Paul and Apollos are working together in partnership, which is what we do in our church. There's many people that you've been investing in and watering the garden and praying for and crying over, being an example to, and you gently have invited them to come and be part of one of our services. It's just as important to invite someone as the investing in someone, that they're going to be loved on when they come to the vineyard. They're not going to be judged. They're not going to be criticized. They're not going to be condemned. They are going to be invited to enjoy the love of God. They're going to be challenged that God has better things for them than what they're experiencing. We have a church that's designed intentionally to be an inviting church, that we have the guest in mind. And you often know, that's why I tell you why we do coffee and free bread. It's not for you. You get to get in on it, just like when you order the pizza, you get to get in on the pizza, but it's about blessing the delivery person. And that's our mission. There's blessing in it for us, but that's not the motivator. Our motivation is we want lost people, people far from God, prodigals, people that think, well, the church will fall in on my head if I walk in there. No, it's not. And we're going to say, hey, glad you're here. You know, we never make fun of people like, here's my friend, Pastor. You know, he hasn't been to church in 10 years and it's a miracle he came. No, we train people to don't embarrass your friends. Don't, you know, just let them feel encouraged that we're honored that you're our guest. We give free gifts out. And it's just little reminders that say, we thought about you, we expected you, we wanted you. When we speak our Spanish terms in Spanglish, bienvenido, I never say it right, but they don't care because they feel affirmed that we cared about who they were as they came in, different ethnic groups, different languages. And we want to be a church that we're in process of watering and sowing and watering, waiting on God to give the increase, having hope and faith. We want to partner with each other. One role, the nursery worker, is not less important than the worship leader. And it's not less important than the person doing dishes in the kitchen or that cleaned the toilets or that is preaching the word. We're a team. When we ring the bell and we rejoice with heaven because somebody has said yes to Jesus as Lord, we celebrate together. It's a win for all of us. It's not Jamie's win or Kim's win. It's our victory that we've labored and worked for. And that's what my prayer in this series is, that if there's one out of all the groups, and somebody becomes missional, someone connects with, I'm an ambassador. Someone begins to be a gardener in God's garden and begins to plant and water and to be intentional about who's your one. And those lives that are changed, God gets all the glory, but there's blessing in it for us. And there's a partnership with each other, but there's a partnership with God, that He guides us. He puts the one in front of us. I mean, we have literally seen people that you'd have to literally ignore God not to see. You'd almost have to rebel to say, God's put this person right at your doorstep. He's put them right in your face. There's a reason you've got this person in front of you, or this person in your life, this person on your job, this person that God's moved, because He's trusting you to partner with Him. He's already at work in their life. When we show up and bless someone with a free meal or give a generous tip and a God bless you and pray, offer to pray for them, which is one of the best ways you can ever, ever be a witness, is to say, is there any way we could pray for you? And, oh, no, I'm good. No, we'd love to pray for you. Well, okay, maybe just pray for my family. Well, what's something specific? Now, we're not trying to be rude, but it's just good if you have the time. We walked up to a little taco a trailer that's new on our where we live, and and we got to meet them, and the great little tacos, and there's like seven people crammed in this little trailer making tacos and burritos, and you know they're busy, and we didn't try to preach at them, and we just said, you know, we're glad you're here, we're glad you're on our island. Could we pray for you? And they look kind of, and there's a language, you know, we just want a bendición. We want to pray a blessing on you. And they're most, I've rarely ever met anybody that goes, I don't want a blessing. You might, and okay, well, God bless you. But they said, yeah, we didn't get all religious and, oh, God in heaven on it. We just said, Father, we just pray a blessing on these hardworking people that you, and I tried my Spanglish. I said, muy bendición, Papa, muy bendición. En el nombre de Jesús, gloria a Dios, amen. And I'll throw in an English in there with a, you know, they don't care about my Spanglish. They care about my Jesus. They care about my heart, my wife's heart, to be a bendición, to be a blessing to them. And that's what Paul's talking about here. We're all playing together. We partner with God. What a mission. He lets us be part of his garden. He lets us go in and pick the fruit. What a joy to come into his garden and to work in his garden together with him and with others in his garden. Who's your one? Let's pray together. Father, I just pray that Lord, as we bless people in your name, as we're aware of being your representatives, as we look for the one, Lord, I pray that you'll give us creative ways to be kind and to encourage and to pay that person's toll at the bridge, which doesn't happen much anymore now that we just drive through. But Lord, you give us creative ways to be blessings to people. And generous and kind, because that's who you are. Lord, we thank you that we plant, we water, but oh God, all the glory goes to you as you make it grow. Lord, give us fruit. Let us see new believers at the vineyard. Lord, open the door as we invest and invite others to come. Let us see many bells being rung by people saying yes to you as Lord. Bless these groups, Lord, as they share together in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.